Good evening and welcome. I am Jan Hughes, Vice President of Human Resources at the Council on Foreign Relations, and on behalf of the Council, it is my pleasure to welcome you. This is the first conference on diversity and international relations hosted by the Council, the Global Access Pipeline, and the International Career Advancement Program. This conference has been made possible by the generous support of the Robina Foundation, the NEA Foundation, the Association of Professional Schools of International Affairs, and OIC International. The conference will be starting this evening with a keynote session featuring Ambassador Lomellin, followed by our reception. Tomorrow's events will begin with a networking breakfast and include a plenary session with NASA Administrator Charles Bowden, as well as a variety of sessions on foreign policy issues, professional development, and engagement with foreign policy professionals. Now I'm very, very pleased to introduce E. Thomas Rowe. Tom is the co-founder and senior advisor to the Global Access Pipeline, GAP, director of the International Career Advancement Program, ICAP, and the associate professor and former dean of the Joseph Corbell School of International Studies, University of Denver. Please join me in welcoming Tom.
Thank you, Jan. On behalf of the Global Access Pipeline and the International Career Advancement Program, I want to join Jan in welcoming you to this first conference on diversity in international affairs. For many years, I, like most of you, have been extremely concerned by the low levels of diversity in the senior leadership of the United States, particularly in international affairs. We all know that despite having our first African-American president, and despite making progress over the last 30 years, our leadership in government, in nonprofits, and in the private sector is still overwhelmingly white and disproportionately male. The U.S. population is currently 37% minorities, and in 30 years, so-called minorities will have become the majority. So at present, we have about 63% non-Hispanic whites in the U.S. population, and it's a declining percentage. So then what does our leadership look like? Frankly, it still looks mainly like me. 83% of the U.S. government's senior executive service is non-Hispanic white. More than 85% of the most senior positions at the State Department and at the Defense Department are non-Hispanic whites. In the nonprofit sector, in the nonprofit organizations, 86% of the board members of U.S. nonprofits are non-Hispanic whites. 82% of the executive directors of nonprofits are non-Hispanic whites. So, what about the private sector? What's the record at the most senior levels? Not so good either. 90% of the directors of Fortune 500 companies are non-Hispanic whites. 96% of Fortune 500 CEOs are non-Hispanic whites. Fully 97% of the board chairs of Fortune 500 companies are non-Hispanic whites. We know, or we should know, that for leadership to be legitimate, it ought to reflect the diversity of the population it leads. In addition, beyond that more or less moral argument, we also know that an increasing number of studies, we know from those studies that diverse leadership produces more carefully considered and smarter decision making. More diversity means more creativity, it means more innovation, it means better adaptability to a changing world. and Lord knows, we could use smarter decision-making, more creativity, more innovation, and better adaptability. If we want the United States to survive and to thrive in the world, we need leadership that reflects the diversity of the American population. We don't have that now because we haven't made an adequate effort to bring it about. Our future as a country depends on our ensuring that we create a new and diverse leadership drawing on the talents of our entire population. And that fundamental truth explains both the Global Access Pipeline Project and the International Career Advancement Program. Both essentially seek to advance the United States by advancing the quality and diversity of United States leadership. I founded ICAP, or the International Career Advancement Program, 17 years ago because I saw, as a dean of an Association of Professional Schools and International Affairs, as a dean in those schools, I saw that graduate schools of international studies were producing a larger and larger pool of highly talented professionals of color who had graduate degrees, but most of them were not acquiring the leadership positions that they deserved. In the absence of adequate mentoring, in the absence of career advising, in the absence of peer support, and in the absence of participation in the right social and professional networks, they were not advancing at the rates that they should be advancing. So ICAP, International Career Advancement Program, is designed to deal with these types of problems, these types of issues, not necessarily explicit discrimination or explicit racism, but the structural problems that help to perpetuate the existing system. More recently, I helped to establish the Global Access Pipeline Project because we all know that we also have to work on the pipeline. GAP, the Global Access Pipeline, GAP is a consortium of individuals and organizations working to recruit, to educate, and to retain folks from underrepresented groups in order to help them consider, to prepare for, and to advance in international affairs careers. We want to develop joint projects, share best practices, and figure out ways to make the pipeline more effective. Our members range from K through 12 programs to college level programs to graduate master's programs to mid-career professional development and leadership programs to senior policy and research institutions that recognize the advantages of diversity. We want to ensure that the pipeline is as effective as possible in creating a large, talented, and credentialed pool of promising folks interested in international affairs. Then we want to be sure that the people in that pool are recruited into senior leadership. The quality of our futures depends upon the success of that effort. And for that reason, we hope that any of you who are here or are not yet part of the GAP project but share our goals will consider joining us to make the pipeline more effective. We hope that if you are mid-career professionals, you will consider becoming part of the ICAP family because that family will help you in your careers. And we hope that if you are currently in the high school and college levels of the pipeline, that you will persevere and help us ensure that we have a more effective and a more representative leadership over the long run in the United States. So that's our aim. This first conference on diversity in international affairs has been the result of the funding and work of so many that we can't acknowledge them all, and Jan has thanked our funders, so I won't repeat that. However, we do need to thank the Council on Foreign Relations for providing us with this wonderful venue and the staff to put the conference together. We need to thank Richard Haas, Jim Lindsay, and Chris Tuttle from the Council on Foreign Relations for supporting the conference and ensuring that we could hold it here. We need to thank Jeff Goulot and the conference staff of the Conference on Foreign Relations for their exceptional work in handling the logistics of the conference. We need to thank Jan Hughes for also from the Council on Foreign Relations for her exceptional work on the conference. We need to thank Ashley Kwaku and the other members of the ICAP 2012 class for the organizing committee that helped put together the program. Zarina Durrani from the Brookings Institution for her efforts over the past year, and the work of the board of the ICAP Alumni Association, and especially the Alumni Association President, Charlotte Key. However, there's really one absolutely amazing person without whom there would be no conference. For the last year, despite having a full-time job as a U.S. Foreign Service officer working in New York at the UN mission, Kimberly McClure has worked voluntarily and tirelessly to make this a success. More than any other single individual, she's the explanation why we're here tonight. We all owe Kim a very special thank you. So once again, welcome. I expect we will all find this an educational and enjoyable conference. I know that it's an important one for the future of United States leadership. So I'll now turn this over to LaTanya Mapp Fret, Vice President Global at Planned Parenthood Federation of America, a member of the 2001 ICAP class, and a board member of the International Career Advancement Alumni Association. LaTanya?
Thank you, Tom, and to Charlotte, the president of the ICAP Alumni Association, and to all of the members. I have to stoop down and get this beautiful but big award out of here. There we go. I'll put it up here. I have the distinct honor this evening to be here with you for what I think is an incredible idea, Kim, and from the beginning, I just thought this would be very special. And just meeting the few of you, particularly the ones in high school who I have, I know this is going to be a really exciting couple of days for everyone. So every year, the ICAP Alumni Association awards what we call an International Career Advancement Program Award for Diversity. And I'm here to present that this evening for Ambassador William Itau. And I'm very, very happy that we have this opportunity to honor him, because he may not remember this, but in 2001, which was a sort of abbreviated year for those of us in Aspen because of the buildings came down right in the middle of our ICAP experience. So many of us had to take off. But we, even though a lot of us didn't have the opportunity to spend the time with him that we would have had usually, he has been there for us to answer any questions by email. He always takes our calls, and so I'm going to go through your bio, but I just thought it was very important from the outset just to let people know the kind of the kind of person that you've been for the ICAP program from the very beginning. So it takes, I think, a special public servant to be able to serve for the last 50 years in the extraordinary way that you have for the U.S. government. Ambassador Itao was born in Japan, where his father was a professor of economics, and he moved to Canada before he relocated to New Mexico and graduated from the University of New Mexico. But he started his career as an Air Force officer, and 30 years later, he became the United States Ambassador to the Kingdom of Thailand. But before all of you run out and sign up for the Air Force, I have to tell you a little bit about all the work that he did in between. He taught at Humboldt State, and then he became the Executive Secretary of the National Security Council at the White House, the Executive Secretary of the Overseas Presence Advisory Panel, which examined the United States presence around the world following the tragic bombings at the embassies in Nairobi and Dar es Salaam. And during his very rich and long tenure at the State Department, he lived in such places as England and Australia, and he earned recognitions and awards, including the Charles S. Cobb Award for his support of the American business community and an honorary doctorate in economics that was presented to him by His Majesty the King of Thailand. But tonight I want to focus a little bit on why he's getting this award and why the International Career Advancement Program Alumni Association does this award. An award recipient should exhibit a long-term commitment to the career and personal development of underrepresented groups in the international affairs community. The award recipient should take affirmative steps to mentor and assist minority professionals to rise to the highest levels of international public service. And the award recipient should maintain a personal and professional commitment to facilitating the goals of the International Career Advancement Program. And so unquestionably, Ambassador Itao embodies these values for us, and he has personally endeavored to bring more diversity to the international affairs arena. Rather than retire quietly to Albuquerque with his wife, the ambassador continued to mentor future leaders through his work with the Honors Study Abroad program at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. And as the director of this program, the ambassador introduced numerous students to the diverse bodies of professionals in the public, private, and nonprofit international career sectors. So essentially, from the inception of this program, the ambassador has been a consistent supporter of the work that we have to do, the work that Tom talked about. And he has mentored countless mid-career professionals, including myself, for more than a decade. He serves on our advisory board, but more importantly, teaches and mentors ICAP participants. I know the latest class of ICAPers were honored to have him there in September, and I had the privilege of also being there in September in Aspen. And as one member of the 2012 class said, Ambassador Itao's life is a terrific example of the virtues that greater diversity can bring to foreign policy decision making, and it's invaluable for that he's willing to share his experience with all of us. And during the course of his State Department career, his work with the University of North Carolina and his long association with ICAP, he has made similar valuable contributions in the realms of international public affairs, and he has promoted diversity and inclusion of underrepresented groups at every turn. And with that, I want to ask the ambassador to come and join me as I present him with our ICAP Diversity Award for 2013.
Thank you very much. That's it's almost like being in Hollywood in the Oscar ceremony. And I don't actually know whether that's an Oscar or maybe it's a Lifetime Achievement Award, but whatever it is, I'm eternally grateful, and I'm really pleased to be able to have the opportunity to join all of you here this evening. During your very detailed comments about my past history, I guess not everyone knows that I was born in Japan and I actually lived in Canada, but I had a friend of mine that I worked with in the NSC quite a number of years ago, a guy named Eric Liu, and some of you may know him. But he wrote a book, a very interesting book, about sort of growing up as the son of immigrant parents, but growing up without really having the identity of his parents. He was born in the United States, grew up in a rural suburb in Connecticut. And anyway, at some point, he writes in his book, The Accidental Asian, about discovering that he's an Asian. And among other things, he said was sort of going in the mirror and trying to get ready and go out to, you know, a date with the girls in his high school class and sort of discovering that he had Asian hair and what a challenge that particular experience was. Well, I've always thought that if I ever wrote a book, I would probably write to Eric and ask him for his permission to use the title of The Accidental American, since I was actually a landed immigrant in Canada. And then my mother remarried an American, and we ended up in Albuquerque, New Mexico, and that's where the story continues. But I have to say, you know, in this big debate, once again, about immigration reform in this country, that I have a particularly strong view about the importance of making sure that our country is really open to everyone, and that we continue to be a great example of how people can come from anywhere in the world and really rise to the top of their fields, their chosen fields in our particular society. And I'm always grateful for that. I'm really grateful to Tom and to the Council on Foreign Relations, the other, everyone who's been involved in this particular occasion. It's really quite an honor for me to be standing in front of you and accepting this award. I just had a conversation, actually I had an email from a friend of mine, a high school friend of mine, about 3 weeks or so ago. He lives somewhere in eastern Oregon, and he communicates every once in a while, but it was one of those messages that says, hey, check this out, and of course it's a link to a YouTube video. And it turns out that the YouTube video was some reunion concert of a group called The Venturers, who played a song called Walk, Don't Run about 40 years or so ago. And at any rate, the interesting thing about the video is that the original drummer was there, and he is now a 4-star general in the Air Force. And my friend also sent me this video because he reminded me that at one point, excuse me, when we were juniors in high school, he actually had a proposal of putting together a rock and roll band. None of us knew anything about music, but we thought it'd be kind of neat, and you could kind of get the girls and everything else. And at any rate, his idea was that I would be the drummer, and I thought, well, that might be possible. So for about 2 weeks there in my junior year in high school, I actually thought about going out and trying to get my parents to finance the purchase of a set of drums. Anyway, I guess the point there is that a lot of life's choices are sometimes made for you, and it's good because I had absolutely no musical talent, and I'm sure that would have gone nowhere. I did try the Air Force. I made it to first lieutenant before I left the Air Force and pursued other things. But it is interesting how, for my North Carolina students, we often bring them around town. In fact, we had a very good session with Chris Tuttle here at the council this spring, as we did last spring as well. And one of the questions that the students invariably ask of the people who are before them is the question about, how did you get into this job? And of course, the answer is always, well, I didn't really plan for this. I did this, and I did this, and this led for that. And it really underscores the fact that it's sort of a combination of where you are and how you're networking with other people, how opportunities arise, and whether or not you're able to take advantage of all that. And I think this is what ICAP has really been all about for all of us. You know, I've been eternally grateful for Tom. That's one of the decisions I think that I made that was a good one, was that Tom invited me a number of years ago to come to Aspen. And I have to say, for the first year, my motivation had to do with coming to see the Rocky Mountains again. The weather was going to be better than Bangkok. But from that point on, I was really committed and really hooked. And I think a lot of the senior advisors who have been there year after year after year are there, not really for the senior, but really for the companionship and the community that ICAP really brings. I have said this often, and I really believe this very, very strongly, that whatever modest contributions I make to the ICAP meetings every year is really overshadowed by what I actually learn from the participants in the ICAP program. And I can remember having a conversation like this with the late Roy Atherton many, many years ago about why he thought that Tom's creation of ICAP and the work of ICAP was really so important. Just one example of the kind of networking and mentoring process that goes on. One of the early ICAP participants was a gentleman by the name of Roy Potts, who's known to many of you. And Roy was a State Department student. He was a civil servant in the State Department working in the IG, the Inspector General's office. And when I started up my North Carolina project, where we bring students from Chapel Hill and bring them to Washington, and of course they meet with foreign affairs professionals, I immediately thought of Roy, because by that time he had moved to the Human Rights Bureau and was actually involved in writing the Human Rights Report every year. So for two or three years, Roy was one of our regulars, you know, contributing, of course, and going back to the connection that we had established at ICAP. And then he moved to New York to work for the U.S. mission at the United Nations. And, of course, we take our students to New York every year, and so it's quite a natural thing for us to go visit the U.S. mission in the United Nations. And for several years, Roy was one of our presenters to talk about UN reform and other issues that he was facing along with the U.S. mission at that time. And then Roy's current incarnation, he works for the Department of Homeland Security. And he works in asylum and refugee, and particularly asylum policy. And so 3 years ago, I remember I called him up, in addition to, of course, having him as one of the speakers. I asked him if he could take an intern, because I had a particularly promising intern, and we're always looking for intern placements in our program. And he accepted a young man by the name of Sean Maxwell. And Roy turned out to be the perfect mentor, really shared a lot of experience, and convinced Sean that his future really was in Washington, D.C., and in some sort of international affairs capacity, or certainly public policy capacity. So Sean now works for Congressman Price of North Carolina and is a full-time staff member in that particular congressional office. And Sean actually has been one of our mentors in our North Carolina program. So he is actually giving back much of what he learned working with Roy Potts. And so to me, it's just one of many, many examples sort of comes to mind about how these kinds of connections really do make a difference. There are all sorts of networking stories that you'll hear from your ICAP colleagues over the next couple of days or so. Amazing stories how people have made that particular connection, people have helped other people find positions, people have helped with advice on career changes and choices. And it's really quite a pleasure for me to be able to stand before you and accept this award and express my gratitude to Council for Foreign Relations, of course, for hosting us here. As a longtime member of the council, I think we've often talked about the fact that we certainly, as an institution, need more diversity. I'm very happy that there are some ICAP alums that have been brought into the council. I've also been very, very proud of having written some of those letters in support, and I hope that the council will continue to support programs like this to give us a more diverse institution as well. And certainly Tom's work at ICAP, not only with ICAP itself, but also what he's doing with the pipeline in trying to really develop the cadre of new future leaders of our country. And certainly that's, to me, the real message about ICAP, because all of these the participants, the mid-career participants that have been through the ICAP program for all those many years now are in, of course, as we expected, in very serious senior and responsible positions in different agencies and different walks of life. And they are the ones that are really going to be the future of our country. And I'm very proud to have been at least a minor player. And I'm very happy to accept this award on this particular occasion. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Kim McClure, and it gives my heart so much joy to see you all here. Thank you for joining us. I want to take a moment particularly to say something to the students. As all of the adults in this room know, it is very important to have global skills, but I think that for you all as students, you all will be the first generation for whom having global skills or not will really set you apart from the competition and really make a difference in where you go going forward. So I want to not only thank you for being here, but congratulate you for having the forethought and the wisdom to take advantage of this opportunity. So thank you very much. I have the distinct honor this evening of introducing and moderating our keynote session with our speaker this evening, Ambassador Carmen Lomellin. Ambassador Lomellin is the U.S. permanent representative to the Organization of American States. Ambassador Lomellin was confirmed by the U.S. Senate in this position with the rank of ambassador on November 20th of 2009. The ambassador was also appointed back in May of 1998 to the position of Executive Secretary of the Inter-American Commission of Women, known as the CIM, for the OAS, by Secretary General Cesar Gaviria. She served as CIM Executive Secretary until March of 2009, and in that position, she provided guidance and direction to the OAS member states and permanent secretariats on hemispheric policy advancing issues affecting women, particularly in the areas of human rights and gender equality. As head of the CIM Permanent Secretariat, Ambassador Lomellin oversaw the activities of the Commission's delegates representing all 34 democracies in the Western Hemisphere and managed the daily operations of the Permanent Secretariat. She most recently served within the OAS as Director for Outreach within the OAS's Department of External Relations. Outside of the OAS, she has incredibly interesting experience as well. She served in the Clinton administration, where she held the positions of White House liaison for the U.S. Office of Personnel Management and director of that agency's Office of International Affairs. She was an advisor on Hispanic affairs to the White House's Office on Women's Initiatives and Outreach, as well as search manager in the White House Office of Presidential Personnel during the 1996 presidential transition, where she worked on sub-cabinet appointments in the area of international trade. Ambassador Lomellin has also got quite a bit of experience in local government, particularly in Chicago, where she worked for Mayor Richard Daley as director of the Private Industry Council of Chicago, and also implemented and managed one of the nation's most successful graffiti abatement programs. Ambassador Lomellin has worked for the Mexican-American Legal Defense and Educational Fund, where she was the Director of Leadership Development, and for Chicago United, a civic think tank, where she was Director of Economic Development. In addition, she has extensive experience in the private sector, working for the Chicago-based Inland Steel Company in various sales and marketing capacities. Ambassador Lomellin holds a Bachelor's of Science degree in business management from St. Joseph's College and an MBA, a Master's in Business Administration in International Business from DePaul University. She has spent a major part of her professional and personal life working on women's issues, particularly those in the U.S. Hispanic community. So as you see, we have quite a powerhouse and force of nature with us tonight. So thank you very much, Ambassador Lomellin, for joining us, and I will turn it over to you for opening remarks.
Kim, thank you so much. I know your parents are amazingly proud of you. They're here, by the way. You should recognize your folks.
Yes, hi, Mom and Dad. Thank you for coming.
Good evening, everyone. I'm absolutely delighted to be here this evening. To the Council on Foreign Relations, thank you so much for this invitation. Dr. Rowe, Ambassador Ito, such a pleasure. Ms. Hughes, it's a pleasure to be here. I also want to thank the sponsors of this event for recognizing the importance of investing in our country's youth, especially our diversity communities. So thank you. This could not have happened without your support. For me, this is a wonderful opportunity. I'm kind of like the squeaky wheel over at the State Department, in that I'm always nagging and complaining and pushing on the issues of diversity or lack thereof at the State Department. So for me to actually get a chance to talk to you about some of what I believe and think of and how I'm hoping that we can work at State to change those numbers a little bit. So I thank you for this opportunity. You know, this is so exciting to look out and see all your faces. This is terrific. I wish I had a camera. You should take a picture from here over there. Okay. Thank you. Because I really believe that you all represent the best of a rising generation prepared to really build on the great achievements of those who have come before you. I talk to young people very, very regularly. And one of the things that I mention, because I came from Chicago. It wasn't the East Coast, where many, many of our distinguished diplomats have come from. But, you know, I always tell kids, you know, I don't know at what point I became conscious of the State Department other than a mention in the newspaper or on the news. I think, really, it was as an adult. So the fact that all of you are here already focusing on an area that is not only so vital to American interests, but such a dynamic and exciting area, you're leagues ahead of where I was. I didn't know what I was doing at your age. So this is very, very exciting. It's really an extraordinary gathering, I can just sense your dedication and your enthusiasm and your commitment. I think it's exciting that you're taking ownership and responsibility, not only to advance your paths, your lives and your careers, but also working collectively to promote the advancement and opportunity by enhancing the quality and diversity of U.S. participation in international affairs. You are the definition of the 21st century. Working with the Council on Foreign Relations and the Global Access Pipeline, you are helping to expand opportunities for the underrepresented to achieve leadership positions in international affairs. And you are exploring the ways in which you will contribute to your communities and to your country by putting your own special, unique stamp on the world. And most importantly, you are working to advance America's interests because, as the president and other presidents before him have stressed, our greatest strength is our diversity and our people. A diversity that enriches the American story that our diplomats share with people the world over. Working at the OAS and now in this position, it's interesting, I look around the room and we're in the Permanent Council, and I've gotten to know so many of the ambassadors and their staffs. And to a great degree, the people that make it into their diplomatic corps are sons and daughters of elite communities. Their parents had resources, their parents knew someone, their parents had access to the decision makers. That's so different from what we have here, where we value the contribution of the individual and the contributions that, as people of color, we have to make. Speaking of my own personal perspective, and as a daughter of immigrants, like many of you, I traveled pretty far from the steel mills of East Chicago, Indiana, to where I am now. I think you heard a little bit of my background when Kim was sharing my bio, other than I can't keep a job for very long. I've had to, like so many of you, had to work very hard to get here. And I remember when I was finishing high school, and this is a long time ago, I'll grant you that, but I remember a college counselor suggesting to me that I should study home economics. I don't think they even have that as a curriculum anymore. No, and you're looking like, what is she talking about? But back then, it was what young ladies studied, so they would be lovely wives. So it is a different world, and they're looking at me like. So the world has changed, and I think all of us have amazing opportunities before us, and it's going to be exciting, I think, as you go along in your career, facing the challenges. And there will be challenges. It's not easy. It is not easy. I remember when I was at the OAS, a gentleman who had been a Foreign Service officer and was my boss. This was when I was heading up the Women's Commission, and I was at with women ministers from throughout the hemisphere. And we had a reception, so of course he was invited because he was the boss. And he says in front of all these ministers, he said, you know, when Carmen first came to the OAS, my first thought was, what can someone from Chicago possibly know about foreign policy? But you know what? She's done a good job. So I think that's just an illustration of some of the challenges and misperceptions and misconceptions about people like us that maybe didn't do the Harvard, Princeton, Yale, the I-95 corridor universities, but we were from, oh my God, Chicago or Wisconsin or Colorado or wherever, and we are just as good and have as much to offer to our country and certainly to the State Department. Recently, Secretary Kerry spoke at the University of Virginia, and he stated, in today's global world, there is no longer anything foreign about foreign policy. Our lives as Americans are more intertwined than ever before with the lives of people in parts of the world that we may have never visited. Speaking from personal experience and based on my background as a daughter of an immigrant growing up in an immigrant community, I always felt a great sense, first of all, of appreciation of what this country had given my family, and also a sense that I had a responsibility to give back, whether it's been mentoring young people, sharing experiences, trying to help to open the door. And I urge you, as you're going through in your career, because you're by the fact that you're here, I know you're stars. You have to bring some, if you bring just one person with you from behind, you will be making an incredible impact. I think this is why it's really vital that all of us as citizens remain engaged in world affairs. The State Department has recently embarked on an effort to, they call it reaching out to diaspora communities. I don't particularly like that word, but that's just me. But it's really reaching out to the community, our communities where we came from. My parents came from Mexico. In this country, that we have a wealth from our immigrant communities, whether it's Korea or El Salvador or Haiti, and to engage at that level, because when we come here, we are Americans to the core, but we also in our hearts have some space there for our country of origin, whether it's three generations or six generations, that spot in our heart is still there. And using what we know and what we understand culturally and through our family ties, spiritually, we can help forge and create America's foreign policy. And guess what, guys? This responsibility is going to be yours. You are a new generation of innovators and game changers. I was listening to, was it Kim, talking about tweeting or not tweeting? Oh, it was Jen. I'm like, who even knew? I still don't know what a tweet really is. But you all are so far ahead of so many of us at this stage in the game that you're going to shine incredibly. You're going to work to advance the promotion of democracy, the respect for human rights and religious freedom, development, and certainly and hopefully advancing the true equality for women. With this, I think we're reminded of the important need to work together and to keep constant vigil in order to preserve our hard-fought gains. The world isn't easy, and I know Kim is at the United Nations. We were speaking a little bit about the dynamics, that it's a complicated world. There was a time when the United States would demand this is what we want, and we got what we want. The world is different. I think that President Obama really stated it beautifully when he spoke in 2009 at the Summit of the Americas in Trinidad. He said, we want to make policy with you, not for you. He extended his hand in friendship and cooperation, and I think that has really started a new era of a real partnership and cooperation, certainly in the Western Hemisphere, and I would venture to say in the world that you inhabit too, that the world is complex and dynamic, but with all your backgrounds and your experiences and your knowledge and your willingness to just forge ahead, there's a word in Spanish. The word is called ganas. You know what it means. You have to have the ganas, the will to really forge forward and really not only attain your personal goals, but give back to your communities, give back to this country that has nourished us so beautifully. I want to thank you for being here. I want to thank the Council on Foreign Relations. To quote Secretary Kerry again, he said, we know that the most effective way to promote the universal rights of all peoples, rights and religious freedom, is not from the podium, not from up here, or not from our Congress, or not from Pennsylvania Avenue. It's from the front lines, wherever freedom and basic human dignity are denied. Again, thank you for letting me share some thoughts with you, and we'll see where the interview goes. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ambassador Lomellin. So for those of you who are new to the Council on Foreign Relations, what we usually do is have a little bit of an interview-style dialogue, and we will then open the floor up for questions from you all, particularly interested in hearing questions from our students this evening. One important reminder, tonight's session is actually on the record and is being recorded, so I want to make sure that everyone is aware of that. So Ambassador Lomellin, I want to make sure that our audience gets a real sense of you as a whole person in terms of your personal life, your professional life, and how you've sort of been able to tie your passions together over the course of your career. So please tell us a little bit more about you, your career, and particularly what made you first get interested in international affairs.
I guess I got interested in international affairs because I'm basically very nosy. My mother, may she rest in peace, would always say, why are you sticking your nose where it doesn't belong? But I would always argue with her that, I belong. I really belong. And I wanted to know, I loved history. I was passionate about politics. Growing up in Chicago, you kind of do, it by default, you are very interested in politics. And I always wanted to know a little bit more. And the international pieces, of course, my parents were from Mexico. We still, to this day, have very, very strong connection to Mexico because of our family ties. So for me, it wasn't international, it was family. And that led to more and more interest and an increasing awareness of my interest in becoming more involved. I remember when I went to graduate school, I decided to major in international business. And I remember my boss telling me at that time where I was working, he said, why are you going to do, what are you doing? You know, Chicago's not an international town, Chicago. And I said, no, but this is something I'm really interested in. He goes, well, you're going to get stuck doing the same stuff anyway, so go ahead. So there was not that, back then, that interest in going outside of our world. I think now with the communications the way it is, the instant awareness of what's going on in any part of the world, I think has given you just a real advantage. In that you don't have to do a lot of digging, it's there. So I kept studying, I kept getting more and more active in local politics. And I liked it, I ended up working for the city of Chicago. I did have probably one of the strangest jobs, which was mentioned. I ran Mayor Daley's graffiti abatement programs. But that right there gave me a real opportunity to see the real impact of public policy. I remember Mayor Daley telling me once, public policy isn't worth the paper it's written on if it doesn't impact the community and the people. So that was a very valuable lesson. And then early 1992, I was asked by the chair of the Democratic Party of Illinois if I would please, Governor Clinton and his wife were coming in and they wanted to meet some of the Hispanic leadership in Chicago. And would I please take Mrs. Clinton around? My first reaction was no. No, I mean, come on, I was an experienced, at the age of 30-something, an experienced political operative. I'm going to be hanging out with somebody's wife. Yeah. She actually told this story at my swearing in. Actually, I believe the phrase that I used was, I don't do spouses. But I was fortunate in that because I met her. And she's an amazing person and was an incredible Secretary of State, and her commitment to women's issues is historic. So I got very involved in the Clinton campaign and then had the opportunity to come out here to Washington. And even then, I was really not doing solid international work. I was at OPM where I ran the Office of International Affairs, and that was governments would come in, interest in reforming civil service systems, and they would leave. So it wasn't real international. And then I knew the administration was going to end, and I had to do something. This is not going to last forever. So a friend of mine, who I think
Dr. Rowe, you talked about the importance of networking. Somebody I had networked with, I helped, I, you know, just, you know, went out to brunch with, she was my predecessor in the Women's Commission, and she said, I'm going to be leaving. Are you interested? I said, no, I've already done women's issues. I don't want to do it anymore. She said, look, do it for a couple years. It'll get your foot in the international. I know that's what you want to do. So I ended up staying there for 10 years in that job. But the beauty of it, I had on the job, trial by fire, immersion into Western Hemispheric affairs. It was not easy. I didn't have that background, but you have to learn because you have to, you know, you want to make sure you get your paycheck every 2 weeks. So that was my introduction, and I will be forever grateful because I know Latin America like the back of my hand. I know the policies, I know the politics, and I know the players. And I think the same technique or my interest since I was a kid, always wanting to know more, always being really, really curious. I love to talk to people, trying to find out what makes them tick. And when you're talking to folks from different countries, it's a fascinating learning experience. I encourage you, reach out. It's a great way to learn. And then when President Obama was elected, I had hoped to be able to work in his administration, and then I got the call from the White House and they offered me this position. Honest to God, if you would have told me even 5 years ago that I was going to be the U.S. ambassador to the OAS, I would have asked you, what are you smoking? It was so beyond the realm because, again, I don't come from that world. But they recognized my experience and the contributions that I could make. The fact that I was a Latina probably helped. That's okay. Don't be afraid of that. Don't be afraid to say, yes, I am good at XYZ, but I'm also African American or Japanese American or Hispanic American. Don't be afraid. Because from my perspective, it is a great value added to what you have to contribute. So that's kind of how I got here.
Given your wide breadth of experience in international affairs, local government, international business, what in your experience have proven to be sort of the biggest hurdles to having more diverse engagement across the board in the realms of international affairs and international business?
Some of the greatest challenges. I'm not sure I understand your question.
So why do you think we don't have the level of diverse engagement in these fields that we need to?
You know, because I think it's lack of information. I don't think a lot of college counselors or high school counselors, it's not on their radar screen. And this is something I tell folks, don't get offended. It's nothing personal. But like hires like recruits like. It's not a conscious effort to push people one way or the other. It's just not on the radar screen. So that's where we, all of us, have the responsibility, and Dr. Rowe, what you're doing with this program is amazing because you're creating that space and creating that awareness of the contributions that all of us can make in the international arena.
I know that in my own experience as a person of color working in international affairs, I've often felt torn between two very strong passions. One is a passion for foreign policy and working on issues that often take me overseas and in a sense seem to take me away from my community. And at the same time, having a passion for wanting to work on the many issues that I know my community back home needs help on. And so I've often in this career field, and I know that a lot of other folks from communities like ours, this is a hurdle for them in terms of, you know, feeling that tension and wondering how am I going to balance these two passions. So I'd love for our audience to hear from you in terms of how you've been able to balance these passions over the course of your career.
It's the particular issues that I'm passionate about. I've always, all my life, have worked on women's issues, issues of civil rights and discrimination. I remember when I really, when I started working at the Mexican American Legal Defense and Education Fund, that was almost like my aha moment, which had really opened my eyes into the real issues affecting a lot of our communities, poverty, lack of a good education for kids, hunger, access to opportunities. And I found that we can make all the noise that we want, but if we're not sitting at that table negotiating, it's going to take a lot longer. So once I got into the international arena, it was just transferring over just a little bit because it was still the same issues. I worked on gender issues. It's human rights, women's human rights. One of my big achievements that I'm very proud of was that I brought the issue of global trafficking in persons to the OAS. And it's protecting the rights of women and children, creating an awareness of why women need to educate their children, or helping to create an awareness of why you need to invest in women and in their communities. So the issues are the same, whether they're here in the United States, or in Mexico, or in Nicaragua, or Brazil, or Trinidad, or Haiti. The issues are the same. Different levels, of course, but the issues are still there.
For the professionals in the room and the employers, I'm sure that a number of us would love to hear your thoughts on sort of how we can better recruit more diversity into these fields, and how those of us who've already sort of gotten a foot in the door can really reach back into our communities and make sure that our communities are engaged in global issues and realizing that these issues abroad actually have connections and impact our communities at home.
I think, and certainly the issue of recruitment, is instead of staying on I-95, take I-70 and go west. Get outside your comfort zone when it comes to recruiting in universities, because go to Ohio, go to Illinois or Wisconsin, New Mexico, go west, and you will find extraordinary talent and really, really sharp young people. And I would say the same thing to employers that are here. Expand beyond the usual. Go recruit to the universities where they do have diversity. There are a lot of programs. Historically, black colleges and universities, Hispanic Association of Colleges and Universities. There are a lot of organizations that could provide the kind of support and can provide the kind of information that you really need to expand that talent pool. There was another part to your question, I know.
Sort of how those of us who are already working in this realm can get our communities engaged in global issues.
That part is something that I kind of beat people over the head on a regular basis. And you have a responsibility to bring somebody in behind you. If you've made it into the State Department, you have to show some young person how you got in.
Say that again.
If you have made it into the State Department, you have to bring in somebody else. Share the information of the programs that are available, and internships, stay in school programs, obviously the Pickering and other fellowships. They're there. I personally think we have to expand them a little more. But as a person in the State Department, I really think you have that responsibility. And I try very hard to bring in young people as interns into my office and get them trained. Once you're in the door, you'll figure out how to stay.
I want to turn a little bit towards your work at the OAS. And particularly for our students in the audience, I think it'd be beneficial for them to hear a little bit about what the OAS is, sort of what do you do on a day-to-day basis, and what in particular are the United States goals at the OAS?
The OAS multilateral work is really very, very interesting. It's exciting. It's frustrating. It'll drive you to distraction, but it is terrific. At the OAS, which is a lot simpler than the United Nations, believe me, we deal with 34 different countries with 34 different agendas, with 34 different definitions on democracy or human rights or citizen security, et cetera. So there are, at any given time, you will be juggling 5-6 balls at the same time, and at the same time trying to figure out how you're really going to promote the U.S. agenda. It's a complicated time in the region. There have been different blocks formed, some deliberately to exclude the United States and Canada. So you find out very early on that you have to pretty much, you know, what you learn in kindergarten, play well with others. If you can work with other member states that share your same view on any given issue and work it sometimes, you know, you do an end run and make sure that the U.S. Perspective is included, and we work via resolutions. You want to push a certain issue, so you talk to Colombians, for example. We work very well with them. What do you think about this resolution? Do you think other member states would accept it? Goes, oh yeah, it sounds great. Would you mind presenting it? We'll sign on, but could you present it? So it becomes somebody else's idea, which is fine, as long as in the end run, it's exactly what we were hoping to achieve with that particular resolution. It's very frustrating at times because there is a real assault on basic democratic values right now in the region. There are efforts to really substantially weaken the Inter-American Commission of Human Rights, for example. There is an assault on freedom of expression. And those are some of the, you know, tougher issues that we have to deal with. We also have very complicated issues like the whole complex issue of citizen security, transnational organized crime, drugs. We're going to the OAS General Assembly in June, and the main issue for discussion by the foreign ministers is new strategies in the fight against drugs. It is potentially a difficult issue because there are member states that just want to legalize the use of all drugs. They say that the reason they have problems is because it's our fault, because we consume. They have issues with trafficking in firearms, but of course it's our fault because they come from the United States. It's going to be a difficult subject to discuss, but we are hoping that we can frame it within the much broader picture of transnational organized crime, drugs as public health, the recognition that it's not just a law enforcement issue, it's a gender issue, it's an issue of inequality, it's an issue of human rights, and how do we work with others on really having an impact in this fight against drugs, and also the fact that one country alone cannot do it. It's not just the United States writing out blank checks hoping that the money will take. It's I have to say both Mexico and Colombia have stepped up to the plate beautifully on this particular issue, in that the experience that Colombia has had on drugs, I mean, I'm sure you all know the history, and now what Mexico is going in through, and that whole Central America corridor, they've really stepped up to the plate. Again, it's not just the United States. It's partnerships and coalitions to really, really get things done.
We're a little bit short on time, and so even though I have this long list of questions, I want to share the wealth and open up the floor to our audience members to ask questions. And hint, hint, I would love for our first question to be from one of our students in the room. A couple of reminders to give you 10 seconds to think of a question real quick. Please wait for the microphone and speak directly into it. When you do get the microphone, please stand, state your name and your affiliation, so either your place of employment or if you're a student, tell us what school you go to, where you're from in the country, and what organization brought you here this evening. Feel free to raise your hand. Yes.
Hi, good evening, everyone. My name is Soraya Diggs, and I'm from New York City, and I go to Elizabeth Irwin High School. I'm here with the International Youth Leadership Institute, and with their program, I was able to travel to Ethiopia for 4 weeks last summer, and I'm going to be traveling to Brazil for 4 weeks this summer. My question has to do with my interest in women's issues. Since October, I've been working on a video on street harassment between men and women, so I'm really interested in knowing more about your experience with women's issues and the kind of work that you've done.
Well, the bulk of the work that I've done has been from the policy perspective and supporting initiatives throughout the hemisphere on making sure, first of all, that or educating on the fact that gender is a cross-cutting issue. I really fought like crazy to quit ghettoizing women's issues, because what happens then? Oh, you're working on all these issues. Oh, and then there's women. No, wait a minute. Women work, it's a labor issue. Gender is an issue of education. It's an issue of justice and human rights and social inclusion. So you have to work it across the board. So that's mostly what I did. I also supported efforts to increase research on gender-specific issues. I mentioned the issue of trafficking in persons. When we first started this initiative, I was told flat out, you're crazy, it doesn't happen over here, it happens over there. We don't have trafficking in this hemisphere. I think time has shown just a whole different story, but that's some of what I've done. I think what I would suggest to you, I think it's tremendous that you're working on this video, congratulations. And reach out to people that work on gender issues. Certainly here in D.C. there's tons of organizations, as in New York, and in college or at school, if someone is teaching gender issues, try to engage them outside of the classroom and really get their input on how they view the issues that you're working on. But congratulations.
Thank you.
Sure.
Thanks. Any other questions? Professionals as well. Everyone's welcome. Yes, we'll do right here.
Hi, my name is Michael Cruz, and I was a PPIA fellow in 2011. I'm currently a high school teacher in Newark, New Jersey, and I teach Latin American history to students in the inner city. For many of my students, international politics is the furthest thing from their mind. How can I, as an educator, encourage my students to get more involved in these issues when there's so many other things that draw their attention away?
High school is very distracting, isn't it? I would say for your class, bring in speakers that may interest them from people working on international relations, whether it's someone from a university or someone from entertainment that's working from a different perspective, not United States. Assign films, for example, that focus on Latin America. I know there have been some tremendous, since it's Latin American Studies, there have been some amazing films coming out of the region. I see my friend Josue from the State Department nodding. You need to talk to him. You need to talk. This is what we need to do. He is in the Department of Education and Cultural Affairs, and they do a lot of what you're interested in, so talk to him afterwards. Thank you.
I saw a question way back there in the back, in the black jacket.
My name is Patricia Costa from El Paso, Texas, the University of Texas at El Paso. And I went back to school 30 years after I graduated in 1976. That'll tell you my age. And it was a big shock when I did go back to school. And through HACU, the Hispanic Association of Colleges and Universities, opened the door for me into a whole new world of government jobs, and they do this through a lot of students worldwide as well as Puerto Rico and so forth. And I thank them for all the opportunities. They've opened the doors to me in so many ways I would not have had the chance in El Paso. Now my question to you is, being a female and from Mexico, did you feel that you were overlooked in a lot of positions because, one, you were female, two, Mexican or Hispanic, and were looked over for positions because of that?
Absolutely, without a doubt. Let me share a quick story with you. When I was working at the steel mill, I had worked my way up, and I was in the sales department. And I got my MBA. I'm thinking, okay, this is it. That was the key that was supposed to open this fabulous corporate door. And I overheard my boss talking to his boss, and they were discussing the Carmen problem. What were they going to do with me? I had gotten my MBA, but they didn't know what to do with me. because they still saw me as this Hispanic kid that, that worked her way up and worked her way through school. And my boss's boss said, oh, we don't have to worry. As long as we give her periodic raises, she'll be fine. It broke my heart, but I got so angry that I found another job. And it put me onto a completely different path. So, yeah, it's out there. I mean, there for all of us, and I think at any given point, anyone in this room has felt this, oh, they're looking at me a little differently. Deal with it and use it as an opportunity for growth.
Actually, I want to follow up on something you mentioned with a question myself. You mentioned that one of the issues that the OAS is quite focused on is that of civilian security, which is essentially sort of tackling the issue of violence against civilians, it's citizen security, tackling the violence against civilians. And I want to point this out because I think it's a great example of an international issue that hits home very strongly as well. You know, if you look at the issue of gun violence, we all know very well how it's affecting a number of our communities, whether in Chicago or here in Washington, D.C. It's also having quite a big impact on communities overseas, particularly throughout the Americas. Just to throw out some statistics, people often point to Mexico as one example. In 2011, there were over 22,000, quote, intentional homicides, leading to a staggering intentional homicide rate of almost 20%. You compare that to the U.S., where the number of intentional homicides documented for 2011 was 14,600. So that's less than 22,000, but not an insignificant number. The percentage in the U.S., whereas in Mexico, it's 20%. In the U.S., it's 5%. But we know in this room how much harder our communities are hit by that type of violence. So I'd love for you to talk about sort of how the OAS looks at this issue that has a clear impact on our communities here at home and sort of widens the lens to try to impact or try to address this issue across the Americas.
It's one of the pillars of the work that we do. And it's true, violence knows no borders. In Honduras, for example, they've got one of the highest rate of homicides of journalists. Gender-based violence is still a huge regional, global problem. Trafficking in persons is a global problem. But I think if we're really going to effectively address these issues that impact the citizen security, you've got to look at the root causes. It's poverty and lack of opportunity. Let me tell you something. If you have a family and you've got mouths you have to feed, and all of a sudden, and you're in Honduras or Nicaragua or any country, and somebody offers you $5,000 a month, you will think you hit the lottery. You will think you hit the lottery. There's a very interesting book, harsh. It's very harsh. It was ghostwritten for a former Mexican cartel member. It's called El Sicario, S-I-C-A-R-I-O. And it really looks at where a lot of the recruits for these cartels come from and how they bring them in. And again, it's the issue of the lack of opportunity. If you don't have an education, you're not going anywhere, anywhere in the world. But if you have an education and you still can't find anything, or if you have a job but you're barely making a living wage, you know, a policeman may make $150 a month. And again, somebody offers him $15,000 a month. Boy, that's one big temptation. So there are so many issues that surround this core issue of poverty and inequality. And I think from the policy perspective, yes, we have to work on the harsh issues of drugs and terrorism and trafficking, but we also at the same time have to look at it through the lens of social development and work with other countries to make sure that we develop programs that are going to positively impact the communities. I'll very quickly, because I know you're running out of time, but I'll tell you just a little story. at the last Summit of the Americas, Secretary Clinton announced a program called We Americas, and it stands for Women's Entrepreneurship Americas. And what it does, it provides technical assistance to women that are trying to start businesses or trying to grow their businesses. And the whole concept being, you know, the importance of investing in women. I was in Nicaragua a few years ago, and we were working on a project on gender-based budgeting. Basically, it goes back to the question, you know, on how to, what do we do? You try to insert gender into different policies. So we're talking little towns, you know what, you know, 1,000 people maybe. And they were trying to introduce the concept of public budgets and what they meant. So what they did, they, as part of the program, they took the men separate from the women, explained what a budget was, how it works, how it impacts their community. Then they asked the men, if you had a say in your budget, what would you ask for? The men asked for soccer field, baseball field, lights for the soccer field, and more recreation areas. The women, on the other hand, asked for paved roads so that their feet wouldn't get cut up when they went to grind their corn. They asked for paved roads so their kids could get to school. They asked for schools. And they asked for a greenhouse so that they could develop a business that they could grow flowers and then sell them and again, reinvest in their community. So I think that that's just a little microcosm of how we address some of these broader, complicated issues. And you start at the community level. Mm-hmm. What policy is going to impact this community and this family, and how are we going to improve their lives?
Other questions?
Yes.
Good afternoon. My name is Ronald Perry. I'm also from Chicago. I'm completing a master's degree at Carnegie Mellon University.
Cubs or Sox?
That's
an important question.
I am from the South Side, so I guess I'll say Sox. Okay. So I wanted to know, I think that we're pretty comfortable acknowledging the issue of diversity, the lack of diversity, you know, racial undertones. But in a community or an organization where that's not necessarily the norm to acknowledge those issues, how do you find it bringing it up around people who might not even be aware of them?
You mean like at the OAS?
Anywhere.
question.
It's a real good question. Let me take it from the OAS perspective. Because you are dealing with 34 different countries. I remember, because all my life, Hispanic issues, I was really active in my community, and I get to the OAS, and one of the first things I'm faced with was, oh, you're a gringa. No, I'm not. You know, it just completely turned things around, because they saw me as American, not as a Hispanic woman. There are very, very serious issues on the issue of diversity in the region. There are huge indigenous populations that are completely marginalized. The Afro-Latino populations in Latin America really have it harsh. There are countries that don't think they have a problem. I was in Chile once, it was during the World Cup, and Chile was going to be playing Cameroon. And in big letters in a newspaper, it said, and I'm going to paraphrase it because it was in Spanish, it said, the Negroes are very disorganized. When I heard, I just kind of like, oh, what? And the guy that was driving said, what's wrong? I said, look what that says. It's son muy desorganizados, referring to the team. I said, you can't say that. And this guy says, but it's true. I went, no. So I try to engage him in conversation to try to understand. And I said, do you have an Afro-Chilean population? And this guy says, in all seriousness, with no malice, no. You know, they don't like the cold weather, so they won't come over the mountains. I mean, it was like stereotype after stereotype after stereotype. So a lot of what has been happening through the OAS is creating that awareness of the beauty of the diversity in the Western Hemisphere, and that we have to address all populations. The Bolivians have recognized it very early on. They call themselves the, I'm thinking in Spanish, but basically acknowledging that there are multiple populations. in Bolivia, and that's part of their official title. They've done that well. And increasingly, the countries with indigenous populations are recognizing the need to focus and help the indigenous communities. But it's a struggle. And then you also have a lot of classism, which kind of complicates everything. So it's not an easy test, but it's something I think the OAS has to work on. I don't know what your experiences are, Kim.
I would say a couple of things that I've learned to do is, one, if I know that there's an issue that needs to be raised, say it's a meeting, I learned a very important lesson in grad school, which is to always sort of walk into the room having already sort of shored up your allies. So you never walk into a room and raise a really big and controversial issue, you know, by yourself, because you don't want to be isolated when folks get defensive. It's always important to have a few conversations with colleagues who you think have also seen the same thing, no matter what their background may be. A lot of them, you know, you'll find will support you. So it's important to say, you know, this has really been bothering me. I want to raise it at the next meeting. What do you think? You know, if I raise it at the meeting, will you at least, you know, say that you also see this as an issue that needs to be addressed? And that can be a really effective technique for not letting yourself get isolated. And if you're not finding that support, you know, make sure that outside of work, you're engaged in networks like ICAP and GAP, because in some ways we exist for that very purpose, to help each other strategize, you know, on the personal and the professional. So, you know, how do I get from my job at the United Nations to this job in Brazil that I want? But also, I'm struggling with this issue as a person of color in my department. There's nobody else in the office who's going to back me up. What do I do? Because I still think it needs to be raised. So there are definitely strategic ways that you can deal with this. And there are people out there. This room is an example of folks who want to be helpful to you in this. So you should never feel like you're alone. We are. I know I speak for all the adults in this room to say, we are here for you. We are mentors. Always feel that you can reach out. I know there was a young man in front of you who also had a question. Please.
Good evening. My name is Jose Camacho. I'm from the University of Puerto Rico, Rio Piedras Campus.
Ooh, all the way from Puerto Rico.
Proud Boricua. Yay. and I'm here thanks to the Hispanic Association of College and Universities, HACU. And my question to you is, back home, my female counterparts, I am a political science student, and they wish they could get to that point where they can actually get involved in politics. But unfortunately, it's a very underrepresented field in terms of, you know, women representatives. And I see you, and I really appreciate that you are in the position that you are, and that you are an hermana, a sister, Latina in power. And I am wondering, can you please give me some words of wisdom, some gotitas del saber, to bring back home and try to compel my sisters, my hermanas, to get to politics and maybe follow in your footsteps?
I think what I did, and I can, you know, I can base it on my experience, is I was always interested, so I started volunteering. Back then, we used to stuff envelopes. I did a lot of that. I would answer phone calls. I would just be there. I would volunteer at events because I knew I couldn't write a $1,000 check, but I could certainly help at an event. So I started getting my foot in the door that way. And also, too, if you want to encourage them to get more involved, what are the issues? You know, you have to highlight the issues that are important. Look, this guy's running for the school board, and he has absolutely no qualification. You've got to do something to stop it. Or you want to help somebody get elected because he or she would be so beneficial to your community and your family. You have to give them a sense of what's in it for her or for them. Very few people do things for altruistic reasons, really. It's what am I getting in return? What's in it for me? Why should I get involved in this race? Why? Because, you know, it's going to impact the lives of my children. Or it's going to be a safer drinking water. Or I know Puerto Rico, crazy traffic. I want more traffic lights. You have to make it a personal thing. And you'll spark that interest. There are amazingly qualified women in Puerto Rico. I mean, really strong women. So I just talk to them. Just talk to them and, you know, keep getting involved. And, you know, gotita por gotita, you know, one little step at a time, and you look where you might end up.
We're going to take one final question from our audience. I'm going to take it from this young lady over here.
Hello, I'm Kasima. I'm a sophomore at Garfield High School in Seattle, Washington. I'm here because of One World Now. So I was wondering that, since lots of countries have a stereotype of what an American is, like a Caucasian American, how do you think people from other countries would react if we sent a person as an ambassador of a physical appearance that's drastically different from a stereotype of American?
We do that all the time. Look at me. We have ambassadors, for example, that are African American, that are Latino, that are Asian. Ambassador Locke, I believe he's Japan. It's interesting because I know the experiences that I've had at the OAS. Sometimes being a Latina, people look at you a little different. They want to go after you, but it makes them uncomfortable because you're kind of like them. So it can sometimes change the dynamic of the conversation. We were having a very, very harsh debate on immigration, which is such a complicated issue for not only for this country but throughout the region. And they started going after the United States on our policies. And I really spoke up on the fact that wait. Immigration reform and the human rights of migrants is very personal for me, because of my family, because of my extended family and my community. And it changed the tone of the discussion because, she's kind of like one of us. She understands. So that it can be very, very positive to not send, your stereotypical American diplomat. And it could have a positive impact.
If I can just add to that, I definitely have to say that in my own experience, I've also found it to be actually a huge asset and advantage to be a person of color in diplomacy. I think we're at a point nowadays where, we have a black president, so people in other countries at least know that black Americans exist now, but that wasn't that wasn't even the case when I started out as a diplomat 10 years ago, and I have to say, use it to your advantage. There are times when I can walk into a room and I know they're not assuming that in that crowd I'm the U.S. diplomat, so I can kind of listen to conversations and overhear positions before I actually introduce and say who I am and where I'm from. In other contexts as a person of color, oftentimes people in other countries know U.S. history far better than Americans tend to know other countries' histories. So they know the legacy and the struggles that people of color have had in the U.S. And because they know, given the perception of America as an arrogant country, and they know the experience of minorities in the U.S. and that we have a unique understanding of oppression within the U.S., they often look to connect with us a little bit differently and sort of draw out the conversation differently and approach conversations about policy differently. And it allows you to be more effective even when your ultimate goal is to argue for the U.S. position. And then finally, I would just say, we as minorities in the U.S. and our engagement in diplomacy and in the realm of international relations, we are the proof in the pudding when it comes to U.S. efforts to sort of promote democracy abroad. If the U.S. is doing what it's supposed to do internally, and in order for it to be able to practice what it preaches and have a more effective message abroad, we have to be part of that community of folks who are delivering that message. And so you should feel very comfortable engaging in this realm, given your background and bringing that diversity to the table, because you are actually helping to make the U.S. more effective in its work overseas. So I want to thank Ambassador Lomellin. Please join me for joining us tonight. Thank you all for being here.